अरे बच्चों, आज हम कैलोटिस की टाइप स्टडी को इंग्लिश में पढ़ेंगे। इंग्लिश में सर्कुलेटरी सिस्टम के नाम से हम इसका अध्ययन करेंगे। देर आर सेवन डिफरेंट टाइप ऑफ सिस्टम इन कैलोट्स विच आर टू बी स्टडीड बाय अस। द टू सिस्टम्स, डाइजेस्टिव एंड रेस्पिरेटरी सिस्टम, हैज बीन कवर्ड बाय अस इन प्रीवियस लेक्चर। टुडे वी आर गोइंग थ्रू द सर्कुलेटरी सिस्टम ऑफ द कैलोटस। आई माई सेल्फ प्रेम सिंह चौहान, एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर इन जूलॉजी एट सेठ रंगलाल कोठारी गवर्नमेंट पीजी कॉलेज राजसमंद। एज वी नो, ट्रांसपोर्टेशन ऑफ द वेरियस सब्सटेंसेस विद इन एन ऑर्गेनिज्म इज कंडक्टेड बाई द सर्क्यूलेटरी सिस्टम। दिस सर्क्यूलेटरी सिस्टम consist of cardiovascular system and lymphatic system. The cardiovascular system includes the heart, which is an efficient machine to propel, and the fluid vehicle, the blood, into the pipelines of the arteries and veins. The structure of the heart. The heart of carotid lies in the pleuroperitoneal cavity and occupies a position which is midway between the forelimbs through the ventricle and extend slightly beyond the level of axile. Thus, the position of the heart is rather forward, such as this position indicates a lower grade of organization because such condition is observed in sphenodon. The heart is conveyed by a thin transparent pericardial membrane. The space between the heart and pericardium is filled with the pericardial fluid. The heart is triangular in shape. The auricular region is wider than ventricular region. Sinus venosus. The heart is made up of five chambers. Sinus venosus is reduced and is disposed transversely and dorsal to the lower half of the auricle. It is thin walled and is formed by confluence of the vena cava. The right half of the sinus venosus is larger than its left counterpart and is formed by the confluence of the right anterior vena cava, precaval veins, and posterior vena cava, postcaval veins. The left portion of the sinus venosus is composed mainly by the left anterior vena cava. A constriction marks of the right and left part of the sinus venosus. The sinus venosus opens into the right auricle near the region of the constriction by a semicircular sinoauricular aperture. This aperture is provided with sinoauricular valves. The valves develop from the upper and lower margins of the aperture and free ends of the valves, which is slightly frilled, projects into the lumen of the right auricle. The right auricle is larger than the left auricle and appears darker than the left auricle. The wall of the right auricle is thick and its inner lining is thrown into the number of musculi pectinati, which are projected within the lumen. I repeat it once again. The wall of right auricle is thick and its inner lining is thrown into the number of musculi pectinati, which are projected within the lumen. The left auricle is smaller than the right auricle and it receives a common pulmonary vein The pulmonary aperture is circular in outline and is located on its dorsal wall, close to the interauricular septum. The aperture is not provided with the valves. Internally, the left and right auricles are separated by a thin, muscular and non-perforated interauricular septum. The septum extends posteriorly for a short distance within the ventricle and bears at its posterior tip the auriculoventricular valves. The ventricle is a muscular, spongy and triangular in appearance. Its apex is directed and chordate and bears a thin white cord of tissue. This white thin cord of tissue is called guberniculum cordis. It penetrates the pericardium and reaches the upper margin of the liver. The thick walled ventricle is provided internally with an interauricular septum which divides it incompletely into the left and right halves. This partition has become complete in crocodile except for an aperture called foramen of Peninga. The foramen of Peninga is a communicating aperture between the left and right systematic arc. I repeat it once again because it is an important point to be questioned in the examination. The foramen of Peninga is a communicating aperture between the left and right systematic arc just at the point of crossing after their emergence from the ventricle. The inner cavity of the ventricle has been arbitrarily divided into three regions, namely cavum pulmo nail, situated in the right side, cavum arteriosum or the left hand portion by a muscular ridge. The ridge arises from the right ventral wall of the ventricle and runs dorsal obliquely. Higher up, it becomes horizontally inclined. It then thus obliquely again and take a vertical course. It cuts off the aforesaid cavity. The left and right auriculoventricular aperture lies very close together, being separated by the prolongation of interauricular septum. The prelateral edge of the septum bears the auriculoventricular valves. In the middle of the ventricle and close to the line of demarcation between the auricle and ventricle, there are three apertures from which aortic arches rises. The inner wall of ventricle is provided with thick interlacing muscles called columnae cornei. There are bundles of thread-like muscles fibers called corda tendini, by which the valves remain attached to the columnae cornei. The inner wall of the ventricle is provided with thick interlacing muscles called columnae carinae. There are bunches of thread-like muscles fiber called corda tendini, by which the valve remains attached to the columna coronae. Valves. The different compartments of the heart are intercommunicated by aperture having swing door-like flaps called valve. Swing door-like flaps called valve. These valves control the passage of blood and direct the flow in one direction. The valves present in the heart of glottis are a pair of leaf-like valves in sinoauricular aperture. Spinator muscles acting as a valve in the opening of pulmonary vein into the left auricle. A pair of leaf-like valve formed by the bifurcation of interauricular septum in the auriculoventricular aperture. Three semilunar valves in each orifice from which atrial arches arise. These are the valves present in the heart of the glottis. The valves of the heart are provided with three histological layers common to all blood vessels. The tunica intima, the tunica media, and the tunica adventitia. From inner of the outside, inner to the outside. Of these three layers, the tunica media is peculiar in having specialized cardiac muscles, showing striations and branchings. The heart is supplied with the cardiac branch of the 10th cranial nerve. Mechanism of circulation. In glottis, circulation circuit is double. There are pulmonary or the lesser circulation and systematic or the greater circulation. Pulmonary circulation is conducted by pulmonary arteries which carry deoxygenated blood to the lungs, and in the lungs the blood becomes oxygenated and returns to the left auricle by the pulmonary vein. This is the diagram of the heart of the glottis in different views, ventral views, dorsal views, and diagrammatic section of the heart. This heart represents two auricles and one ventricle along with its sinus venosus formed by the right precaval, left precaval, and postcaval. In the ventral view and the dorsal view represents a smaller left auricle, then bigger size right auricle. This is sinus venosus with left precaval and right precaval. Among, in between these two, there is a constriction, and this is the postcaval. Again, this is ventricle, and last portion, filament like structure of the ventricle, is known as guberniculum cordis. Guberniculum cordis. The internal structure of the heart showing right auricle, left auricle in section, showing pulmonary veins opens into the left auricle by a circular aperture, and sinoauricular aperture is located on the right auricle. This lower part is known as ventricle. The ventricle, both auricle, is partitioned by the interauricular septum, and ventricle is also partitioned incompletely by interventricular septum. This is interventricular septum. Left ventricular, this partition, interventricular septum partitioned the cavity of the ventricle into the right ventricular cavity and left ventricular cavity. The left auricle pours its content into the ventricle through the auriculoventricular aperture. In the greater circulation, deoxygenated blood returns to the sinus venosus by two precavals and one postcaval veins. The sinus venosus opens into the right auricle. The right auricle empties into the content into the ventricle. The ventricle sends blood for the circulation into the different part of the body through the systematic and pulmonary arches. I repeat it. The ventricle sends blood for the circulation to the different part of the body through the systematic and pulmonary arches. The entry and exit of the blood in the ventricle is so beautifully designed and so beautifully arranged that major quantities of the oxygenated blood is always forwarded to the brain region. As ventricle is incompletely divided, a mixture of oxygenated and deoxygenated blood occurs thrice in calotus, once in cavum venosum, once in dorsal aorta, and another in ductus caroticus. This is important point. That's why I repeat it once again with the admixture of oxygenated and deoxygenated blood occurs thrice in calotus. Once in cavum venosus, second times in once in dorsal aorta, and another in left ductus caroticus. Cavum venosus, dorsal aorta, and left ductus caroticus are the part where oxygenated blood and deoxygenated blood admixture. Thus, through the ventricle in the calotus is morphologically incompletely divided, there is a tendency for the physiological separation of the two types of the blood. At least two auricles completely and in the ventricle partially from this point. The heart in the calotus is biologically more advanced than that of the buffo blood. Blood of the calotus is red in color, made up of plasma and blood cells. Blood corpuscles are biconvex, elliptical in outside, and each bear an elliptical nucleus. The white blood corpuscles are irregular in outline and non-pigmented, and each bear a spherical nucleus. Now we come to the atrial system of the calotus. Atrial system, there are six pair of the atrial arches joining the dorsal aorta and the ventral aorta during the embryonic development of the arteries. The third, fourth, and sixth persist in adult calotus and other reptiles. As the ventricle in the calotus and other reptiles tend to divide into the left and right ventricles by the development of an incomplete interventricular septum, the base of ventral aorta splits into the three parts, two parts of which remains in the right part. Right part remains two of the ventricle, and third goes to the left part of the ventricle. Thus, from the ventricle, the calotus arises three carotid arches, two plus one is equal to three. These arches are the pulmonary aorta 1, the two systematic aorta, left systematic aorta and right systematic aorta. These three aorta are wound and around themselves at the source and undergo about 1.5 turns round each other. The aorta are covered at the base by the fibrous sheath and thus appear tubular. The whole diagram is represented in this diagram. So I enlarge it and showing this part is the heart with left and right auricle and one ventricle, from which arises a pair of pulmonary aorta. These are the pulmonary aorta. Then arises systematic arc of the left and right systematic arch. This systematic arch first goes into the esophageal, then complete turn round the heart, 1.5 turn, and at the behind of the heart, at the below of the heart, it forms dorsal aorta along with association of the right systematic aorta and left systematic aorta. These are the two. The both of these two systematic aorta are associated with internal carotid artery and forming ductus caroticus. This systematic, the right systematic arch leading front and bifurcated into common carotid arteries. These are the common carotid arteries. These common carotid arteries firstly bifurcated or opens into thyroidal, then laryngoglossal, laryngotracheal, thyroidal, then laryngotracheal and buccal. This common carotid artery bifurcated into two. This common carotid artery bifurcated into two. Two carotid arteries. This outer one is known as internal carotid and inner one is known as external carotid. External carotid artery opens or goes into thyroidal, laryngotracheal and buccal. And internal carotid artery bifurcated into the palatines and stapedial. After the left and right systematic aorta turns around the heart and join to form the dorsal aorta. Before joining the dorsal aorta, the right systematic artery, there is a branch of the subclavian which goes to the anterior arms and a vertebral goes to the vertebrae. After that, anterior esophageal goes to the esophagus, then gastric, parietal, colic, anterior mesenteric, posterior mesenteric, genital, renal, iliac, at last it iliac bifurcated into the pelvic and external iliac, and again into internal iliac, vesicular, and at last the caudal. After the origination of the each gastric, anterior mesenteric, posterior mesenteric, there is a presence of the parietal veins also, which has been explained in the text in more detail. So again we go towards the text of one by one, we studies the aorta. First, the pulmonary aorta arises independently from the right portion of the ventricle and soon splits into two branches, is entering into the lung and it carries deoxygenated blood. Left systematic aorta originates independently from the right, left of the pulmonary aorta and portion of the ventricle and moves forward to the some distance. Then it curves around the heart and goes towards to meet the right systematic aorta a little. Posterior to the apex of the ventricle, it carries mostly the deoxygenated blood from the left systematic arc. Four esophageal arteries arises. The first of these arteries arises from near the point of insertion to the left ductus caroticus, while the origin of the fourth one is very close to the point of the union of two systematics. Parietal arteries do not originate from the left systematic arc. Right systematic aorta. This important aorta emerges independently from the right ventral margin, the base of the ventricle, and moves forward. It then curves to the right side of the heart. It meets the left systematic aorta posteriorly to form the dorsal aorta and it carries oxygenated blood. From the apex of the curvature of the right systematic aorta arises a single and common carotid artery which advances anteriorly and then splits into the four arteries. The inner part of these four branches of the external carotid arteries, while the outer pairs from the internal carotid arteries. on the both sides parallel to the division of the left internal and external carotid and right internal and external carotids. One thyroid artery is given off from the common carotid. The main branches from the right and left external carotids are laryngotracheal artery, one from each, and three buccal arteries from each. And the internal carotid, both left and right, bifurcates at their tips into the inner palatine artery and outer stipedial artery. The external carotid and their branches supply blood to the face and mouth. The internal carotids and their branches supplies blood to the brain, internal carotid to the brain, and thus it is to be noted that carotid arteries do not arise independently from the ventricles as they do in amphibian, but instead arise from the right systematic aorta. And as the right systematic arches carries oxygenated blood to the anterior organs, especially the brain, this arch is supplied with oxygenated blood. The two internal carotids are connected by systematic aorta of the corresponding sides by ductus caroticus, and ductus caroticus represents the remnant of the embryonic radices between the third and fourth aortic arches. From the right systematic aorta, three esophageal arteries are given up. The right systematic aorta, before it meets with the left systematic aorta, gives rise to a subclavian artery, which bifurcates into two and supplies blood to the four limbs. From the right systematic aorta, a vertebral artery is also originated to send blood to the vertebral column. The point of origin of the vertebral artery is situated very close to the subclavian branch. Just before meeting its left counterpart, the right systematic arch gives a pair of parietal arteries. The right and left systematic aorta unite a little behind the heart and give rise to dorsal aorta, which runs posteriorly to give branches to the visceral organs and posterior part of the body. The following arteries originate from the dorsal aorta chronologically along the anterior-posterior axis. These are anterior esophageal artery. It is single and originates from the ventral surface of the dorsal aorta. The first pair of parietal arteries from the dorsal aorta, which plugs into the parietal of the third thoracic vertebra. The first and second pair of gastric arteries which supply the cardiac stomach. The second pair of parietal arteries. First pair of parietal artery, second pair of parietal artery, then the third and fourth and fifth pair of gastric arteries, followed by third pair of parietal arteries. Sixth and seventh gastric arises, followed by fourth pair of parietal arteries, and then eighth pair of gastric arteries, followed by fifth and sixth pair of parietal arteries. So it is to be noted that number of gastric arteries varies from 4 to 8 pairs. Anterior mesentery, which runs obliquely caudate to supply the intestine. The colic arteries, which runs obliquely cranial to the supply of the pyloric stomach. A splenic artery is given up it to the supply the spleen. 7-8 pairs of parietal arteries. Posterior mesenteric artery or the hepatointestinal artery, it arises from the right border of the dorsal aorta and it runs obliquely caudate. On reaching it, intestine bifurcates into two, anterior and posterior. The anterior is hepatic, supplies the gallbladder, while posterior or intestinal supplies the intestine. Ninth pair is parietal arteries. The right and left genital arteries, the point of origin of the right one is bit up than its counterpart of the left. 10th and 11th pair of parietal arteries. Left and right renal arteries may be more than one pair. 12th and 13th pair of parietal arteries. One pair of iliac arteries. Each branch after its origin runs obliquely to the corresponding hind limb. From each, a pelvic branch is given up to supply the pelvic girdle. Finally, branch bifurcates into the external and internal iliac from near the point of bifurcation, a slender vesicular artery is given up by each branch. The dorsal aorta now enters into the tail as caudal artery. This is all about the atrial system of the calotus. We hope that this topic becomes useful for the students of the BSc classes, and more prominent to the BSc second year in a paper of vertebrates. Now we come to the assignment to be solved this question by my dear students. This is an important topic from the type study of reptiles and calotus. So there are two important questions can be put into the next coming examination. These questions are: describe the circulatory system of calotus with the labeled diagram. And second one is explain the structure of heart of the calotus. I think these two important questions, you have to practice it, solve this question in a booklet, and send to me through the WhatsApp so I can give a feedback to my dear students. Thank you for watching this video. Have a good day. And we think that this video is become useful for my students. Any video we are preparing for you, it takes a long time and hard work. So I appeal and urge to my dear students, you please and please be carefully watch each and every video which becomes useful for the development of your career also along with the examination. Thank you. Have a good day.